the role of ultrasound in the biliary tree. Now, I want to stress on protocols. Now, we are in the era of guidelines, protocols, and checklists. So, for any study, it's better to have a protocol. So, I'll show the steps for studying the biliary tree. First is the knowledge of the anatomy. So, here you see the intrahepatic biliary radicals of the right lobe joined to form the right hepatic duct, and those in the left lobe joined to form the left hepatic duct. Both of them join in the portohepatis anterior to the bifurcation of the portal vein to form the common hepatic duct, and which is joined by the cystic duct from the gallbladder to form the common bile duct. We cannot identify by ultrasound the point of the cystic duct joining, so we use the term common duct to denote both the common hepatic duct and the common bile duct. So the common bile duct enters the pancreas and opens into the second part of duodenum on the ampulla of Wetter. Now, there may be a slight variation in the termination of the common bile duct. The common one is it is joined by the pancreatic duct close to its termination into the ampulla, or the two ducts may open very close together on the summit of the ampulla of Wetter. So, this is a slight variation in termination. Now, the common clinical presentation of an abnormal biliary tree is jaundice. So, once the patient presents with jaundice, the role of ultrasound is to differentiate whether it is obstruction or parenchymal replacement or mixed. So, that is the role of ultrasound to differentiate obstructive from non-obstructive jaundice. Now, obstructive jaundice, the role of ultrasound is to see signs of obstruction and then go to know the level of obstruction and finally the cause of obstruction. As I said, the technique should involve the steps. So, what are the steps? Step 1 is you look for the peripheral biliary radical, and step 2 is scan through the bifurcation of the portal vein, where you will be able to see the right and left hepatic ducts anterior to the right and left branches of the portal vein, and step 3 is the study of the gallbladder, and step 4 is the long axis of the common duct, and step 5 is the transverse scan of the pancreas. We will see one by one. Step 1 is the peripheral radical. You do a scan of the periphery of the liver. So, normally you will see the branch of the portal vein as a single tubular structure. Peripheral radical of the bile duct also accompanies the peripheral branch of the portal vein, but normally it is not seen. But when the bile duct is dilated, it will be seen coursing parallel to the branch of the portal vein. So, that is called the parallel channel sign or the double barrel gun sign. So, if you see this, then the bile ducts are dilated. So, this is again normal bile duct in the left lobe and the dilated bile duct in the left lobe. It's called the parallel channel sign. So, this is step 1. With this, you diagnose whether the bile ducts are dilated. Then you go for the step 2, that is the transverse scan along the bifurcation of the portal vein, where normally you will see the right and left branches of the portal vein, and you will see the right and left hepatic ducts anterior to them, and they are very thin, so usually not seen or maybe seen like a hairline. But when the duct is dilated, then you will see the normal portal vein. Anterior to that, you will see the dilated right and left hepatic ducts and the common hepatic duct. Now, here you see the right and left hepatic ducts are dilated, but at the confluence, instead you see a irregular, ill-defined mass. So, this is typical appearance of a cholangiocarcinoma. Now, step 3 is gallbladder. So, gallbladder, we must look for the long axis scan. It may be normal or it may be dilated, or you may get gallstones in the gallbladder, or the gallbladder may be replaced by carcinoma in a case of jaundice. Then we study the step 4, that is the common duct. Now, common duct will not be readily seen, so you have to go for it. That approach is called the target approach, where it is a technique to get a small or a thin structure like CBD from a large known structure, that is the portal vein here. So, from the portal vein, which can be easily picked up, we go to the small thin structure by their anatomical relationship. So, we will see what is that. Now, this is the anatomy. This is a transverse scan of the portal vein, which is magnified. You see the portal vein, the cross section. Anterior and to the left, you get the branch, the cross section of the hepatic artery. Anterior to the portal vein and slightly to the right of hepatic artery is the common duct. So this, when you take an oblique scan of the right hypochondrium, you will see the portal vein. You rotate to the transducer to get the long axis of the portal vein. So this is easy to get. So from here, by the knowledge of the anatomy, relationship between the common duct and the portal vein. So the common duct is anterior to the portal vein and slightly to the right. So from the portal vein, you move the transducer, make it more vertical, and then slightly move to the right. Then you will get the common duct coming into the field. So this is the technique, and this is called the target approach. We'll see the video. So first get at the portal vein and then make the transducer more vertical, slightly to the right. You get the long axis of the common duct very well. So this is the target approach. You see the common duct very nicely seen. So this is the technique you have to use. And a small information about the terminal part of the common duct. So the terminal part, if you see, the common duct is vertical initially. After entering the pancreas, it becomes transverse to open into the ampulla. So if you keep on doing oblique scan of the common duct, you will fail to see this portion of the common duct, terminal portion. So when you go to the transverse scan of the pancreas, so the common duct will be seen as a dot by the cross section. So from there, you must turn the transducer, tilt the transducer to obliquely to see the terminal end of the common duct like that. If you don't do this, you will miss the pathology of this terminal portion of the common duct. That is the video showing the tilt of the transducer to see the terminal part of the common duct. Another technique, you can go from the common duct. Again, you can rotate the transducer to more transversely. You see the terminal portion of the common duct like that. Okay. Now, that is the common duct. That is normal. And the caliber is equal to the decade of the age. Now, here the common duct is dilated and it is cylindrical. And when you trace it, you see the calculus in the distal common bile duct. So that is the calculus causing obstruction. Next is the step 5, that is the transverse scan of the pancreas. So here you will see the pancreas and you will see the common duct as a cross section in the head of pancreas. When the common duct is dilated, you will see the dilated common duct in the transverse scan of the pancreas. If there is a calculus in the distal duct, you will be seen like this. And in the transverse scan of the pancreas, you also will make out a dilated pancreatic duct. And also you will make out the cause of obstruction as a carcinoma of the pancreas if it is present. So these are all the things you have to see in this section. Now we go to the diagnosis of the causes. Now causes in the intrahepatic portion of the bile duct, the causes are cholangiocarcinoma, sclerosing cholangitis and oriental cholangiohepatitis. Now, sclerosing cholangitis is an autoimmune disease, a very rare disease, causing multiple constrictions of the bile ducts, both intrahepatic as well as extrahepatic. So, the dilated bile duct appears like a beaded structure. It appears multiple areas. And then, in the bifurcation, again, it is beaded. And the common duct also may show strictures. So, this is typical appearance of sclerosing cholangitis. Now, oriental cholangiohepatitis is a disease of recurrent cholangitis resulting in multiple strictures. And because of the strictures, obstruction, dilated biliary tree, there may be multiple calculi in the intrahepatic bile ducts. You see the intrahepatic calculi in the most of the periphery of the liver. And then you may see calculi in the dilated gallbladder and also calculi in the dilated common duct, which may or may not be present. So, this is typical appearance of oriental cholangiohepatitis. Now, in the hilum or in the periphery, you may get cholangiocarcinoma as seen here, which we have seen already. Dilated right and left hepatic ducts, mass in the confluence. Now, hilar obstruction can be one of these. So, this is the oblique scan. You see the dilated ducts and in the hilum, in the common duct, you see a large calculus. Or there may be a stricture of the common duct in the portahepatis, that is the common duct up to portohepatitis, and you don't see the dilated distal duct, and you don't see any cause of the obstruction that is due to stricture. And again similar, but instead of stricture, you see a large irregular mass in the portohepatitis, again a cholangiocarcinoma. Or the obstruction in the hilum may be enlarged lymph nodes, as that is the duct, and that is the enlarged lymph node, and maybe multiple enlarged lymph nodes in the portohepatitis causing obstruction. Now, hilar obstruction can be due to an infiltrative carcinoma of the neck of the gallbladder, as seen here. You see dilated fundus and an irregular mass in the neck of the gallbladder, which can extend and into the hilum and infiltrate the common duct, producing obstruction to the biliary tree. So, a patient may present as jaundice. And a rare cause of obstruction to the common duct and the hilum is Mirrsi's disease. Now, here you see the constricted, contracted gallbladder with calculi, and then the common duct is dilated, and just distal to the portohepatitis you see a calculus. So, this is actually a calculus in the cystic duct, which is due to fibrosis involving the common duct, producing obstruction to the common duct. Now, distal CBD obstruction may be due to one of these causes. We'll see one by one. This is dilated intrahepatic radicals, dilated common bile duct, and you see the calculus in the distal common bile duct. If you take a section, transverse section here, you see the dilated duct in the head of pancreas, and another section here, you'll see the calculus in the dilated distal duct in the transverse scan of the pancreas. The calculus may be impacted at the ampulla, again dilated radicals, contracted gallbladder, dilated CBD, and as I said, you must turn the transducer, rotate the transducer to see the terminal end of the CBD. So, where you will see the terminal end in a transverse section, and you see the calculus in the ampulla, impacted in the ampulla within the gas filled duodenum. So, this is calculus at the ampulla. You may get calculus in the non dilated CBD without jaundice. And here you see the CBD normal, but multiple calculi seen in the gallbladder as well as in the CBD. There may be calculus along with the stent after calculus seen in the CBD in a patient with jaundice. They have applied stent. So, before removal of the stent, they would like to see whether the calculus is passed. So, here you see still the calculus by the side of the stent, which is seen as a tube. A very rare complication of obstructive jaundice is spontaneous perforation of the gallbladder. Here you see ascites because of bile, dilated CBD, and if you see the gallbladder, you see the thick walls here. With high frequency, you see the thick walls, which is due to breach in the wall of the gallbladder, which leak of the bile. So, that is spontaneous perforation of the gallbladder in a patient with obstruction to the biliary tree. Now, obstruction may be due to scoriasis. Now, here you see dilated common duct in both the cases, and in the distal part you see the Ascaris worm as another tube within the CBD. This is called the tube within tube appearance of Ascaris causing obstructive jaundice. Now, here you see dilated gallbladder, dilated common duct, and you see a mass in the distal part of the common duct, and you see what is called the shouldering. So, shouldering indicates that there is thickening of the both the walls of the common bile duct, like the apple core of the colon, carcinoma of colon. So, this is a typical appearance of carcinoma of the distal CBD causing obstructive jaundice. Now, here dilated common duct, transverse scan of the pancreas, you see a cyst in the head, you see calcifications in the pancreas, and you also see dilated pancreatic duct. All features of chronic calcific pancreatitis. Now, dilated bile ducts, dilated right and left hepatic ducts, dilated gallbladder, dilated common duct, and when you see in the distal part, you see a mass, that is the pancreas. And when you do transverse scan, you see that the entire pancreas is swollen and equipoise. So, there is no focal mass. So, this is chronic pancreatitis producing obstructive jaundice, but there are no calcifications. Now, here dilated gallbladder, dilated common bile duct, and in the distal part you see an equipoise mass, And when you do transverse scan of the pancreas, you see dilated pancreatic duct, and in the head you see an irregular mass, diagnostic of carcinoma of the head of pancreas causing obstructive jaundice, dilated biliary tree and obstructive jaundice. Now obstruction may be at the ampulla, dilated gallbladder, dilated CVD and dilated pancreatic duct. So the obstruction has to be in the ampulla. So again, as I said, you must do a transverse scan to see the terminal end of the CBD, you see here, and at the end you see the enlarged ampulla within the duodenum, fluid-filled duodenum. You see a small mass in the ampulla, so that is a periampullary growth, very small periampullary growth producing obstructive jaundice. And the last rare cause is carcinoma of the duodenum, dilated gallbladder with calculi, dilated duct and transverse scan shows dilated common duct in the pancreas, and in the region of the duodenum you see the pseudokidney appearance, and when you do a long axis scan you see irregular thickening of the second part of the duodenum with the dilated proximal duodenum and narrow lumen. So this is carcinoma of the duodenum producing obstructive jaundice. Some rare causes of obstructive jaundice. Now here is a scan of the liver showing a hydatid cyst in the right lobe. What has happened is that is the membranes, that is the hydatid cyst, and when you see here the dilated common duct and you see the hydatid cyst and you see the communication hatch. So the hydatid cyst has leaked into the biliary tree, and the daughter cysts and the hydatid sand has caused obstruction to the distal CBD producing jaundice. Now jaundice may be due to parenchymal causes of one of these. So we need not cover this because the topic is biliary tree. But rarely the cause may be both parenchymal and obstructive, like what happens in hepatocellular carcinoma. Yeah, that is hepatocellular carcinoma replacing most of the right lobe. And there is a metastatic lymph node in the porta hepatis obstructing the rest of the biliary tree causing jaundice. Similarly, a cholangiocarcinoma in the right lobe infiltrating the porta and the left hepatic duct producing dilated biliary tree in the left lobe. So it is both parenchymal and obstructive cause of jaundice. And then post cholecystectomy follow up, you get abdominal distension. So there is ascites due to bile leak, and when you see the bile duct, you see the stricture of the bile duct due to inadvertent ligation of the common bile duct, injury to the common bile duct during surgery, cholecystectomy. Now coming to jaundice in the newborn and children, we are worried about biliary atresia. So in biliary atresia, the ultrasound may show an abnormal, you see an abnormal gallbladder or an absent non-visualized gallbladder. And when you look for the bile ducts, you see the portal vein, but you don't see the dilated biliary tree. So non-dilated biliary tree with an abnormal or absent gallbladder is diagnostic of biliary atresia. Rarely you may see a large cystic structure in the hilum in a child newborn with jaundice, but the ducts are not dilated. But this is actually a double atresia, atresia proximal, atresia distal. As a result, secretions distending the common duct, mimicking a choledochal cyst. Now here there is situs inversus in this child, the stomach on right side, liver on left side, and the bile ducts are not dilated. On the right side you get polysplenia. So this is a typical syndrome, that is situs inversus polysplenia syndrome. Patient is jaundice, then it is biliary atresia almost always. Then we come to the congenital bile duct dilatation, previously called choledochal cyst, and this is the classification. You see the types, and we on ultrasound you see the type 1 where there is cystic dilatation of the common duct, and you see in transverse scan the cyst in the region of the common duct anterior to the portal vein. When you do oblique scan, you see that the cyst is communicating with the common hepatic duct. That makes us the diagnosis of choledochal cyst type 1. So the difference is here there is fusiform dilatation of the common duct as opposed to all the other causes we saw where there was only cylindrical dilatation. Because in other causes there is no fault with the muscles, whereas in choledochal cyst there is weakness of the muscles of the wall. So as a result there is fusiform dilatation. whereas here it is cylindrical dilatation. Now here in type 4, we get a dilated common duct as well as right and left hepatic ducts. So this is the gallbladder, this is the cyst, and you see the transoscan dilated right and left hepatic ducts, and you do the transoscan of the pancreas, huge cystic dilatation of the common duct. In oblique scan, you see the dilated huge fusiform dilatation of the common duct with the dilated right and left hepatic ducts and the common hepatic duct. So that forms the type 4 congenital bile duct dilatation. Now there is a congenital malformation of the bile ducts called the pancreaticobiliary ductal malformation, where you see a long common channel. As I said before, normally the right and the common duct and the pancreatic duct unite just before their opening into the ampulla, or they open very separately, very close together on the ampulla. But an abnormal variation is a long common channel. That is, the both of them join far away, remote from the ampulla. So there is a very long common channel. So when there is a very long common channel, what happens is there can be a reflux of pancreatic juice into the common bile duct, which destroys the muscles of the common bile duct wall, resulting in fusiform dilatation of the common bile duct. So that is becomes the congenital bile duct malformation, which is a theory that there is a pancreaticobiliary ductal malformation in the form of long common channel. Otherwise, there can be reflux of bile juice into the pancreatic duct, which can induce acute pancreatitis. Now here, transoscan of the head of pancreas, here you see the dilated common duct as well as the pancreatic duct. And when you come little low down, you see very close together the dilated common duct containing sludge and the pancreatic duct. And then when you do an oblique scan, you see the long axis of both the common duct and the pancreatic duct with sludge balls in the long common channel. So this is the long common channel. So this is pancreaticobiliary ductal malformation. And this video showing the same. Transoscan, they see separate. When you come down, they unite together. And when I turn the transducer, you get the long axis of the two ducts and joining together to form the long common channel. So that is the two ducts, and that is the long common channel. That is the pancreaticobiliary ductal malformation, which is confirmed by the MR cholangiography. That is the long common channel. Now, bile pig syndrome is a biochemical abnormality, highly viscous bile, resulting in sludge formation, forming the bile plugs in the gallbladder as well as in the filling the common bile duct, cause transient obstruction to the bile duct, and the newborn will present as jaundice. This is a self-limiting disease. They may get passed out. The relief of jaundice. There is a condition called spontaneous perforation of the CBD, where patient presents acutely with pain abdomen and toxicity and distension of abdomen. Scan shows ascites, and it is exudative ascites. The gallbladder is collapsed. And if you see, the common right and left hepatic ducts are slightly dilated, and you get a slightly dilated common duct with a sludge ball. So the sludge ball causes temporary transient obstruction, resulting in perforation of the CBD. Again, this is a self-limiting disease. Now coming to pneumomelia, there is gas in the bile ducts. So here, this is a typical appearance of gas in the bile ducts and the common duct in the oblique scan. And the gallbladder, you will fail to see the gallbladder because it is filled with gas. So when there is pneumobilia, it may be iatrogenic, or it may be gallstoneleus or obstruction with cholangitis. Now here, this is a post-stented pneumobilia, and you see the stent in the common hepatic duct and the common bile duct. So in the patient who has been stented, you fail to see pneumobilia. That will point to obstruction to the stent. Now here, this is a patient presenting with small bowel obstruction. There was pneumobilia and the gallbladder was contracted, and tracing the dilated bowels, it led to a lith causing obstruction. So that was a passed out gallstone. So that is the gallstone ileus. That is the bowel, and you see the gallstone there. Large gallstone perforating the gallbladder and the duodenum and causing small bowel obstruction. Rarely there may be a cold dock or duodenal fistula due to secondary to a calculus eroding or an ulcer eroding. Here you see pneumobilia and you see dilated common duct with a large sludge ball. And in real time, you will see that there is fluid in the duodenum passing into the common bile duct, confirming that it is a cold dock or duodenal fistula. Now, patient presenting jaundice and pneumobilia. So, if pneumobilia, we don't expect the patient to be jaundiced because that indicates free flow of bile into the duodenum. But if both are together, we must suspect obstruction with the cholangitis. So, this is pneumobilia, and put the patient in erect to displace all the gas into the liver so that the CBD fills with fluid, which is becomes visible on ultrasound. And so you see the common duct fluid filled and you see the calculus as the cause of obstruction. With obstruction, there is infection due to gas producing organism causing pneumobilia. Rarely, there may be a very rare cause tumor of the bile duct, that's called the biliary cystadenoma. It typically presents as a multiseptated cystic mass, particularly in children. And it has to be differentiated, mimics hydatid cyst. The pointers are the aged. Hydatid cyst is in the middle and later, whereas this biliary cystadenoma happens in children. Location is more towards the hilum, and with the there may be peripheral duct dilatation because of obstruction, and you may see calcifications within the cystadenoma, whereas calcification of the hydatid cyst will be peripheral. So that is biliary cystadenoma. Thank you very much for your patient listening.